The coin of a moving coin galvanometer have an entrance and an area A. The coin is in a radial field of a magnetic flux density B. When the currents I flow, the coin is refracted to an angle theta, and the sensitivity theta per I of a galvanometer is proportional to. So first thing we have to know the structure of this galvanometer. This is let's say this is N pole and this is S pole. Like this is let's say this is a cylinder shape, and here will produce a magnetic field like so. This is a B field, and now we can start drawing the coin. This is positive terminal. The coin will look like something like this. And finally connect to the negative terminal. The coin have a certain turn N, which given by this N. And now we can see here, this should have a reading here, right? And this is a pointer which point out the reading. Now we can start drawing the current, which for this case it will go like this and go like this and out to the negative terminal. And you can see here this have a B field, have a I, and this will produce a force. In this case here, this is an outward force and this is a downward force. And you can see here is a rotative motion, right? So they will cause this pointer to have a displacement delta, and they will stop at a certain reading. So this motion is driven by torque, which MBAI. And since this thing stopped at a certain reading, we will expect that this torque net is equal to zero. This means they will have another torque. Let's call it a torque prime, which opposes this motion. Right? Actually, this is given by a certain constant multiplied with delta angular displacement. So for the net torque to be zero, so this is the condition, and we will get the MBAI minus IC the delta equals to zero. Now the delta I is equals to the MBA per C. So we can see this sensitivity is proportional to this BAN, which is given by A. Which of the following statement about the motion of a charged particle entering a uniform magnetic field is not true? And A, the path of the particle is parabolic if the direction of the motion particle is parallel to the direction of the magnetic field. The A is not true. This the reason is this is the this word parallel. So as we all know, this we have to let's say here we have a component of the let's say this is F, and this is B, and this is I. This I actually that means the moving positive charge. Yeah, so personally I like to use this I, but some book they will write down this is the velocity of the charge. But basically this is the same things. And you, as you all know, this should be perpendicular to each other, 90 degrees to each other. So if they are parallel, they will produce no force. They will produce no force, so there will not be a parabolic path. So the A is not correct, which is our answer. And now this is B. The path of a particle is circular if the direction of the motion of a particle is perpendicular to the direction of the magnetic field. This is correct because the word perpendicular here. And the force is given by VQV, and will be balanced out with the force mv squared per r, which this is what we call the centripetal force. And so the path will be a circular. So the B is correct. And now look at the C. The magnitude of the magnetic force is directly proportional to the charge of the particle. And from here you can see this is correct. Is this if the B and the V is we make it constant, this should be the proportional. So the C is considered true, and the magnitude of the magnetic force is maximum if the direction of a motion of a particle is perpendicular to the direction of the magnetic field. Well, again, this is a correct statement. You will reach this maximum, and when there is a perfectly perpendicular, if you are not, you can adjust using the sine data to make it perpendicular. But actually, they will not be, if they are not perfectly perpendicular, you cannot have this maximum, because only the certain part, which is the sine data, actually depend how you define this data. But usually by convention we use the sine data. Only the part for this sine data will contribute to the perpendicular part. So if they are not perfectly perpendicular, they are not the maximum. So in this case, this here state that this is maximum if they are perpendicular, so the D is correct. So the diagram below show the three parallel long wire X, Y, and Z, each carrying a current I, which of the same magnitude in the direction shown. So if distance between the X and Y and between the Y and Z are the same, this is the same distance, let's say this is D, this is also D. And which of the following diagram show the direction of the force acting on the wire X, Y, and Z? So first thing we have to know is that if we have a wire, we have a certain current plus 2, and we have a nearby wire like so. This wire will produce a magnetic field like so, and there were experience a force on this wire here, which if there are these two currents going in the same direction, it will be the attractive force. So let's say this is X and this is Y, and this will attract to Y, and this is a force due to this Y, so and this is a force due to the X. And now we have another Z here. Let's say this is the direction of the current is opposite, and when this direction of the current is opposite, they will produce the force which oppose each other in another direction. So the Fy on this Z, well, in this direction, and Fz in this direction. Fz. So you can see if Xx and Fz can be combined to form a greater force, and so we expect this the Y have a direction, the force direction is going as such on this Y. So the we can see here the this A and C are incorrect. And now as we all know, this Z also will produce another magnetic field, which also influence this X. And also because the direction of the current, they will also produce in such a way, F-Z. But since this is a distant 2D, right? This is X and Y is only D. So the magnitude of this FZ will smaller than this FY. So we will expect this FY is bigger and the net force is still going into this direction for the X on this wire X. So we will see that the X have a force in this direction, which is shown in a D. And now we can see this on net force direction is matched out this only D, so the answer is the D. So when the load of the electric motor is decreases, the speed of the rotation of the motor increases, while the current in that flow through it decrease. Which of the following statement explain the decrease in the current? So this the A, the resistance of the coil of the motor increases. This is incorrect because the resistance is basically will remain constant. And second, the power dissipated in the coil of motor increases. This not really explained on the question, so this is also incorrect. The back EMF induced in the coil of the motor increases, this is the reason. So from here, let's say we have V source minus this back EMF. This is well, equals to I per R. You can see this when this EMF increases, the current must be decreases. This is R is just a constant for the resistance, and this is the voltage we input. And so we can see that when this back EMF increases, the currents flow through will decrease. So the answer is C. The D is more difficult for the current to flow through into the coil of the motor. This actually does not explain why on this why the current decreases. This is more like the consequences for this increase in the back EMF. So this does not explain anything for our test. So the answer is C. When a resistor is connected directly to a sinusoidal voltage supply of 240 watt, this is VRMS. Okay, the current has a peak value of 10 amperes. This is I naught, let's say, and the resistor and the power dissipate. So first thing we know this Ohm's law, V equals to IR. And but one thing to should be mentioned is that the V, if you use this as a VRMS, this I should be also in term of this in the RMF form. And if you use this V to be a peak, this I also should be used the peak one. In this case, I will use the IRMS. Anyway, you will get the same result for the R. So this is I naught square root 2. I naught is 10 square root 2. You will get 5 square root 2 amperes. And now we can start calculate. VRMS equals guess this is the, and this is a 240, and this is 5 square root 2. This is R, so I get a 3.94 ohms, so it's approximately equal to 3.4 ohms. And so the only possible here remain is the C and D. Now we calculate the power dissipate. The power dissipate, you should use the VRMS and IRMS. The reason for this is because the no matter the I or V, right, they are not going to be constant. They will be sinusoidal. So this is so they are not going to be always keeping at the peak value, right? So the RMS is more like a total efficient value in general. So these two must should be at this RMS form to calculate this power or this dissipate. So this is RMS is 240, and I is how many? IRMS is 5 square root of 2. So 240 multiplied R I 5 square root of 2. So I get 1697 watt. If we round off, we get approximately equals to 1700 watt. So the answer, we can clearly see the answer is C. A steady current I produces a power P in a resistor. When an alternating current flows through the resistor, the power produced is a 1 over 4P. What is the peak value of an alternating current? So the first thing first, this P is given by the I squared per R. And now we consider, let's say, P2 is equal to the IRMS squared. This is for the alternating current case. Now this is also the same R. Now we know that the P2 is equal to this 1 over 4P. So P2 is equal to 1 over 4P equals to IRMS squared. And R, this P here is actually just I squared per R, the substitute inside. So we get 1 over 4 I squared per R is equals to this I square R. This R can be cancelled out, and this I square is equals to the 4 I RMS square, and we just square root both sides, we will get 2 I RMS. And we know that the I RMS is equals to the I peak, the peak current per square root 2. So we substitute inside, we get IP per square root 2. And now actually we want the peak value of the current, so we should make this IP in term of I. So we get square root 2 per 2i is equals to 1 over square root 2i. So we get the answer is B. The diagram will show an operational amplifier which is connected to a voltage supply of 15 watt and minus 15 watt. And now, let's say this is a VI input and this here is a VO output. If the input voltage is 0.5 watt, what is the potential at the point X? So actually, what we want to find out is this V0, V out. And now let's say this is RI, this is RF. This have a V1. And one thing to mention is that this is, you see this is a positive 0.5 volt, right? They are connected to a negative part here. So that means this is an inverted amplifier. Another way of saying the output should have a negative sign. And so C and D are wrong. Okay, now here for the ideal case, right, V1 is equal to 0 for ideal case. And now here we have currents I1 plus 2, and this is I2 here. And now we can see this in the ideal case, this V1 is 0, they will have the same voltage with this ground. That means no currents will pass through here. So we can conclude that I1 is equals to I2 is, we express it in terms of a voltage, we get a Vi minus a V1 Ri equals to V1 minus this V0 per Rf, right? Now V1 is 0, this is 0, so Vi per Ri is equal to minus V up per Rf, and we want to find out V out, so this is Vo equals to minus Vi. No, we just substitute all the value, is 0.5. This is 100 kilo. This is 10 kilo. This K cancel out. This is, so we get a minus 5.0 watt, which the answer is B. Which of the following statement is not true of an electromagnetic wave? The first is that it can be polarized. This is a true statement, but this is not our answer. Our answer is find out the one, this is not true, and this is a transfer wave. This is correct. You can see, let's say here we have E field, and here is a B field, and here is the direction of it propagating, and here this must be perpendicular to each other. The B, E and V should be perpendicular 90 degrees to each other. So by definition, this is a transfer wave, and it consists of a vibration of a magnetic and electric field. This is also correct. This is why we call it the electromagnetic wave. And the answer is D. The expression for the its speed is a square root of the mu naught epsilon naught. This is incorrect. This is not true. So this is our answer. The correct expression should be 1 over square root mu naught epsilon naught. A monochromic light propagates in the vacuums and enter a gas medium, of which the following is true of the light in the gas. So we are given V equals to F lambda, and we know that the frequency of light will going to be constant. That means there is no change, so the only possible answer is C and D. And now we know that this the lambda will decreases, and so do the speed. So we can see this correct answer is given by D. So a convex lens of a focal length of 6 cm is a contact with the concave lens of a focal length of 12 cm. The local length of the combined lens is, so this is a straightforward equation. We directly use this 1 over f equals to 1 over f 1 plus 1 over f2. Here f1 is, this is 6.0 plus 1 over, this is a negative. This negative is important because of the concave. And now we find out this f, so from this 1 over 6. And we graph 12 cm, so the answer is C.